Anyways, so I don't know exactly the right biography to tell, except for what I've mentioned, so this is David Yale. He's the, I guess, the capital, one of the capital management officers in Metro, and the reality here is that if a project doesn't have a budget, somebody goes to David and begs, and then somehow the money gets found. He's the miracle maker of the company, the public agency. So that's the way I'll describe it, and let's take it from there.
Thank you, Bart.
Welcome.
And thanks, everybody, for coming. A lot of familiar faces here. I'm pleased to see you again. And the crowd actually here reminds me a lot of Railvolution, where you got this mix of activists and consultants who are working on the results of years of transit activism that's been going on. Los Angeles voters have been at the center of that activism for years, you know, with the vote on Prop A in 1980 and Prop C in 1990 and now Mid-Girard in 2008. So we really have a lot to talk about and a lot to do. My history with the organization, with Metro, started as an intern in 1988 and worked my way up gradually over the last 25 years within the planning department. My current responsibilities are the planning function generally, the public-private partnership program, which I just took on about 2 months ago, and I'm beginning to wonder why. It's a very difficult responsibility. And my long-term section is responsible for the transportation improvement program and our long-range plan financial forecast, looking forward only. I don't do any accounting or write any checks. I just look forward at the amount of money we're forecasting to be available for services and projects in the county from our sales taxes and from state and federal funds that we get by formula. Finally, I also supervise the grants department here at Metro. So it's a big responsibility. I've only had it for a couple months. And that couple months have been spent on the public-private partnership program. So Bart's promotion of me as an expert is a little bit ambitious on his part. I'm going to try and live up to the advertising today with a briefing on mega projects. I don't know if that was probably your first email. I didn't capture the unknown aspect of it in my title, but we'll go through it and see how it goes. And I think if I click here, I get the next slide. These are our future projects in Los Angeles County. I've taken this slide and tried to pull out the public-private partnership programs projects that we are still focused on. The projects are the Sepulveda Pass, the I-710 South, the truck lane project with perhaps some other features to it, the 710 North project, which is still in its environmental process, and then the in the North County, the High Desert Multi-Purpose Corridor. I also will be talking today about the I-5 North Express Lanes and the 71, which was part of a P3 project that we are taking a new approach about. So I want to focus on those as well. Later in my presentation, I want to go over our America Fast Forward legislation. This is federal legislation that would enable Metro to borrow at essentially a zero interest rate, with the federal government paying the interest on the borrowing. If we can get that, we can fulfill the 30-10 vision of the board of directors, which is an effort to accelerate all of our Measure R projects and deliver them in a decade. I want to put that in quotes because the first 5 years has already passed and we don't have the finances put together. But we are developing the projects as we go, and the ones that are particularly impacted by the America Fast Forward proposal are the eastern extension of the East Side project and the extension of the subway and several others that I'll go over in my presentation here. So it's a lot to talk about. I hope I don't go on too long.
We're on here by 11.
I have a little sense, but I better go through this. But this 405 project is what we call the Sepulveda Pass. I'm starting in the wrong place. This 5 project is the I-5 North Express Lanes project. It was formerly part of a project called the Accelerated Regional Transportation Improvement Project, which was really a group of 4 projects that were bundled together, and an attempt was made to do this in an alternative delivery method called public-private partnerships. And I want to talk a little bit about what's going on with that group of projects first. These are the 4 projects that were part of the so-called ARTI project, Accelerated Regional Transportation Improvements. The I-5 North capacity enhancements, sound walls, and the State Route 71 widening in the San Gabriel Valley in the Chino-Pomona area. The I-5 North project is shown there in the green is our short-range transportation plan schedule, and the blue is our new recommended plan for delivering these projects. You can see we hope to have some acceleration on the I-5 North, but importantly, and also a new project that would do more in that corridor out later in the plan period. The sound walls, they are shown next, and we also hope to deliver those quicker than the short-range transportation plan that we just laid out before for comment. And then the 71, we're going to divide up into 2 pieces and accelerate the part that is south of Mission. This project was once a bundle, as I've said, and some members of the audience will probably know about the public-private partnership procurement that we started out on. We had 4 qualified teams that we released about 3 weeks ago. And there are 2 main reasons we released them. We want to unbundle the projects and do them separately. The purpose of that is to clarify that the I-5 North tolls are going to stay in the I-5 North corridor. If you bundle them together, it's harder to tell whether the tolls are being used in the I-5 North corridor. We believe by putting them together like this, we can, unbundling them like this, we can clearly show that the revenues are available in the I-5 North corridor, which is a state and metro policy goal. The other purpose of unbundling them was to align the projects better with our financing. We have a large balance in our Measure R Highway Subfund. By the end of this fiscal year, we predict that will be about $400 million. So the anticipated use of the Measure R Highway funds is slower than what we had laid out for ourselves in 2009. There are a host of issues for slower delivery and transportation. I'm not going to go into those tonight, but the impact on this project is we did not feel we had to borrow as much money that we could instead just fund the project directly instead of borrowing it. So that impacted the procurement as well. The next project that's in our P3 program is the Sepulveda Pass. Many of you will know that Measure R has a $1 billion of Measure R funding, and our long-range plan has a complement of another $1 billion in the third decade for transit improvement in the Sepulveda Pass. So this would be some kind of transit link between West LA and the San Fernando Valley. When we put it in the ballot measure, the project was not well defined and remains that way today. What we are looking at is whether or not the Sepulveda Pass transit project could be married up with a toll project of some kind, perhaps in a tunnel, perhaps not, that would enable us to do a rail link or some transit link along with a toll-financed highway facility. Lots of study needs to happen on this. We are currently looking at what's called a stated preference survey to determine the willingness to pay for this project in the corridor. So that will help us begin to size up just how much money you can raise. The estimates on the tunnel range from, I don't know, 5 billion to 10 or even 20 billion, depending on how many access points you have and so forth. So if you are going to do this at grade over the pass, it's a whole different animal and a lot more affordable. So there's lots to study there, and we're working on this project. The next project is our high desert multi-purpose corridor. It used to be the high desert corridor, and then it became the multimodal corridor, and now it's the multi-purpose corridor. The reason for that is they are working there on marrying up a variety of purposes in the corridor, including energy transmission and perhaps energy collection and a solar array of some kind. They're looking at high-speed rail connections that would go from Victorville to Palmdale. That would complement a proposed high-speed rail line from Palmdale to Vegas. So the idea is that we might be able to raise some money by coupling a high-speed rail in this corridor, and also a toll bypass for the metropolitan area of Los Angeles, where trucks could come down the 5, go around the Los Angeles metropolitan area and down to the Mexican border without getting tied up in the urban traffic. So this project has promise, and we have applied for a Tiger grant to do a very detailed study of the ability to raise funds to pay for it. We do have the planning money only in our Measure R program, and we have been participating in the study with that money. So this project's actually got a lot more definition to it. The big unknowns is how and when will it connect to high-speed rail going further north, the main high-speed rail program that the state of California sponsored. And I know some of your favorite projects are coming up next. The 710 North is under an environmental review. When it comes out of that review, it may or may not be appropriate for a public-private partnership arrangement. Some of the options in the review include a toll-based tunnel that is the most likely project, I think, to lend itself to the kind of financing you do in a public-private partnership. Measure R committed $790 million to this corridor, and we are using that funding to do the environmental study. The study was recently delayed until February of 2015. I don't know what this slide even says about that.
Yep.
Down at the bottom.
Down at the bottom. early 2015.
Oh, no, that's old.
That's old. This is the final environmental, and what's really coming out is the draft. Yeah, so this slide is a little bit old. It's tough to keep up with all the detail around here, so I apologize for that. We will be getting Bart, where's Bart? A copy of the presentation. I was in such a jam today, I couldn't copy it for you for this meeting. So I'm going to mail it to you, and you can get it out to the group.
Oh.
To the extent you put your email on his list.
Well, what we can do, and this is what we do with the presentations, is there is a Transit Coalition website, and then there's a review of the history of the meetings. And Tony films the meetings. We always love the work that Tony does.
Okay.
And so we put the YouTube up of the meetings, and then we also put the static PowerPoint. So there's two different things you can click. You want to watch the meeting, enjoy it. And if you don't want to watch the meeting, you can look at the PowerPoint. So
okay.
They're both there, no extra charge.
Okay, so look for that if you're interested in getting a hard copy of this presentation today. The last project is...
Before you, can you call? I'm a little confused now on the environmental. What's
yeah.
How's that going to work?
I'm not the expert on the 710 environmental. It's a very touchy subject. What I do know is that there was a recent transmittal to our board that said the draft environmental document would be released in February of 2015.
It was originally supposed to be this spring, and
yeah.
Then it got delayed by some months, unspecified, and recently, just last week ago, Friday or something like that, they sent out an email saying it would be February 2015.
So, and if we have any 710 questions, there's actually a group of people here that probably know more about it from
yeah.
every angle.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
The
other rudimentary understanding I have is that it's related to RTP modeling or something like that.
Mm-hmm. The delay, yeah. The calibration
yeah.
and verification of
yeah.
But
yeah.
between Joanne Knuckles and Chris Sutton and Clyde and Jen Sue and everybody else, we have the ability to actually help people out and get factual information, and the body of knowledge is here in the room.
Factual information.
Well,
you can try and keep up. That's
yeah,
it's
all.
Part of
that's the best you can do around here. You know, our capital program is about $20 billion, so just keeping up with that is hard enough. This, much of what I'm talking about in the P3 program is there because it wasn't fully funded in Measure R, and so we're looking for ways to do the projects with toll alternatives. And so many of these projects have that toll component in it in order to become a public-private partnership approach that would enable us to deliver these. So we are also, just as an aside here, I think it's probably an appropriate time to talk about, we are studying going to the ballot in June of 2016 with another sales tax proposal for transportation. The initial sort of scan countywide of all the projects that are out there, either in our strategic plan, which is code for the unfunded part of our plan, or that were in unfunded portions of Measure R projects, like the extension of the Gold Line from Azusa all the way out to Claremont. And perhaps Montclair, if San Bernardino picks that up. Those elements of Measure R that were unfunded are also in this list. And then any new ideas that the COGS or cities wanted to propose. We've taken that inventory, collected it all up, put it in one place, sorted it out, and determined there's $100 billion worth of need countywide for transportation ideas that are not currently funded. That is before you add in the city of Los Angeles, so I expect that to grow to a number approaching $150 billion when we finally get all the detail. We are studying how to winnow that down, prioritize it short, medium, and long, and package it up in a way that might work with the voters. So that's a long-term effort we're also engaged in right now. The 710 South is one of the projects that's really going to need a new tax, either at the state or federal level, or from Los Angeles County voters. It's a great corridor coupled with some capacity enhancements from the ports of LA and Long Beach up to Route 60. They are currently studying this project, and it is one of the projects that could have a toll component in the form of a truck lane that's tolled. And we were looking at the public-private partnership program to help fund it. It does have a substantial unmet need, as I mentioned, and we're looking at our new sales taxes. So one of the ways we might address this issue, the federal government is talking about a freight component to what they do. And if there is ever a federal program that Los Angeles deserves, it's our freight program. I don't know if you know, about 40% of the nation's customs fees are collected in this county. That's because 40% of the nation's goods that are coming from outside of the country are coming through this county, primarily our ports. So it's a huge national burden that we're bearing in this county with very little federal funding coming back to us. The next part of my presentation, I'm going to kind of leave the P3 program now and move into our America Fast Forward portion of my presentation. You all are very familiar with this as well. These are all of our transit projects in our Measure R program. This is the short range plan here. So this shows you what we're going to deliver in the first decade, I think, yeah. Expo to Santa Monica, the Crenshaw project, which we just awarded the design build contract for, the regional connector through downtown, the subway to La Cienega, the Metro Gold Line out to Azusa, already under construction, the Orange Line already completed, and the East San Fernando Valley North-South Corridor project, which is in its environmental phase now. So these are just what we want to build in the first decade. We are trying to accelerate other projects. On the highway side, this is our first decade program. The 10, the 5 South, the 710 early action projects are shown. The 110 express lanes, the 10 express lanes, the 405, which I think it opens May 23rd. Am I spilling a secret there? Nope, that's, you already knew that. Okay, so that's opening soon. The 5 North that I talked about earlier in my presentation, and then the I-Desert Corridor. So that's a study only on the I-Desert Corridor. The project acceleration that we want to try and accomplish with America Fast Forward is shown here. We'd like to deliver the Green Line extension to Redondo Beach, from a Redondo Beach station to the South Bay Corridor early. The Purple Line extension to the VA hospital, we'd like to accelerate that. The Gold Line East Side extension, and on down the list, the Metro Airport Connector, the West Santa Ana Branch, and the Sepulveda Pass Transit Corridor. So you can see here the tremendous transit benefit we get if we could find the financing to accelerate these projects. I don't know if I've been here to explain the problem with our financing. This shows the deficit spending that we would incur if we tried to do the entire acceleration program with tax-exempt bonds. These are bonds that today would be in the neighborhood of 4% a year and would be something on the order of 20 to 25 years long, they'd have to expire by the end of Measure R. As, and you can see from this graph that the projected growth in revenues is not enough to support the total borrowing that you would need to do to accelerate our program. So it does not pencil out. The reason for that is the more you borrow, the higher your interest rates are. The graph before was just assuming we used 4%, but some of our more elaborate borrowings would cost even more than that. The first time you borrow, you're going to pay a fairly low interest rate. Each time you borrow more, the bonds are getting in line behind each other. It's like a first, second, and third mortgage. And so the interest rates go up because the risk that you will not be repaid if you're the investor goes up. So at the end of the scale here, some of the public-private partnership style private borrowing that one might experience, if you could interrupt this scheme with public policy intervention, you could dramatically change the picture. And we've started to do that with the TIFIA program. We got an America Fast Forward expansion of the Transportation Investment, the Transportation Infrastructure Finance and Innovation Act. I think that's the first time I've done it by memory. That one's really hard to remember. That program has been hugely beneficial to Los Angeles. We got a loan for the Crenshaw project at 2.43%. The regional connector rate was 3.5%. We just got a loan closed for that. And the subway loan is closing probably May 21st. And that loan, if it closed today, would be in the neighborhood of 3.2%. So rates have come down even since we closed the regional connector loan. Those are very advantageous to our effort to accelerate all of our programs. This shows the new and more important piece of the America Fast Forward strategy, which is a tax credit bond, which would enable us to use for every, say, $10 million of revenue stream, we could borrow a hell of a lot more money using these assumptions. Now, these assumptions would be for the national legislation we're proposing. The maximum term is 35 years and so on here in the details. So this isn't exactly what Measure R could do, but it is what someone could do if they had a 35-year income stream. Measure R is more like 25 years. The structure of these bonds is depicted here. The bond issuer would be Metro. We also happen to be the transportation agency that would be funding the projects and then pledging the revenues back to the trustee who would repay the bond investors at the end. The tricky part of this is this piece where the U.S. Treasury pays the interest. We have a mechanism there that would make it possible for even pension funds to use the America Fast Forward tax credit bonds. So this is an exciting thing we're trying to get. We're still pushing it in Washington. Rafi Hamparian, our government relations guy, and I have traveled the country pitching it, and APTA supports it. AASHTO has put it on its list of things they may support, and we're trying to get it. What would our program borrowing look like? Now, here's the sort of end of the story. If we can get those bonds and layer them in above the TIFIA loans that we've already gotten, our debt service shortfall would go away and we'd have a sufficient cushion to give the bond investors enough comfort level that they would be paid back. So that's how we want to try and accelerate our program. And that brings me to the end of my presentation. I know it's a lot to take in, everything Metro does is kind of huge and complicated, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you guys might have. Maybe we can turn the, did I just turn the lights off, or?
No, I did.
Oh, okay. Is that okay?
Sure, the first question, Christopher Sutton?
Yeah. If one or more of the projects that are now on the list are canceled, would that money be available for other projects, or would that make other projects more likely to be funded?
Yeah, Measure R has some rules about project cancellation. The board can cancel a project or make a finding that it's complete with a two-thirds vote. At that point, the funds would be freed up for the sub-region from which the project came, and the Metro Board, in conjunction with the sub-region that originally had the original commitment, would have to select another project to do. I believe that's also by a two-thirds vote. So that's one sort of pathway to doing that. The other pathway is to amend Measure R. If it's not for acceleration, it requires a one-year notice to the legislature and a couple other notices that are shorter, so that you could, by a two-thirds vote again of the measure, of the board, move the money to whatever you wanted to put it on, whether it's in the sub-region. I think it's unlikely that it would be outside of the sub-region, but there could be a change in Measure R through that mechanism.
Couldn't there also be a change through the state legislature that would just unilaterally make the change and not have to go to the Metro Board in terms of reallocating money?
I don't believe so, and I'll tell you why. The LA County voters approved Measure R, and there's a specific ordinance that they approved. So it has one set of protections in it, and then state law has another set of protections. So you might be able to change one in state law, but the other would remain. So you'd have to get some lawyers to look at, you know, the interaction between a change in state law that did not go to the LA voters, and so the ordinance protections would still be in place locally. You could probably fight that out in courts for years. I don't know. It's not a simple, you know, make a change in state law and you're done.
Jan?
David, the scenario you just described would apply as well, taking money out of highway and into transit or vice versa, not just within the same category.
Right. There are additional rules about a transfer across the modal subfunds, the highway subfund, the transit subfund, and I think there's an operating subfund as well. The transfer from highway to transit or transit to highway can only occur once in any 10-year period and not in the first 10 years, and then it can only occur by a two-thirds vote of the board. So we cannot do a transfer like that until after 2019, and then I believe we can only do it once between 2019 and 2029. So that transfer is further restricted by the combination of state law and the ordinance. I think over here, and then Joanne.
Has there been any interest from financial companies to invest in P3 projects so far? How has this been received so far by investors?
Anyone knocking on your door?
Well. We've not received any unsolicited proposals, nor have we solicited any except for the Artie project, which I described. And there we had four very good teams. The whole issue about how to go forward with Artie was unrelated to the quality of the qualified bidders. They were all very good and went through a screening process. Five proposed, I think four went forward, and when we go out with a formal proposal, we're getting a response, which I think puts the pressure on us to get what we're going to do put together quickly, and that's difficult because of environmental clearances and all the rest, so we're working on it. Joanne, I think you were next.
Okay, I want to talk about projects that are in two sub-areas, like 710 North. 35 to 40% of it is in the central LA district, and the rest is in the San Gabriel Valley. But 100% of the money is controlled by the San Gabriel Valley. So what do you do about, and I think that's an issue that needs to be discussed, because the city of LA has a resolution against the 710 tunnel, but yet the San Gabriel Valley COG is in favor of it, but 40% of the project is not in the San Gabriel Valley COG's area. So what do you do about, in Measure R, projects that are multi-jurisdictional? And there's a debate or dispute or whatever between the two, you know, whether this project would go forward or not between the two sub-regions.
If you cancel it, will money go to LA City?
There are a host of complexities here I want to mention before I answer your question.
Okay.
The first of them is a COG boundary is not the same necessarily as a Measure R boundary. The Measure R ordinance referenced the long-range plan boundary that did not exclude any areas of the county. And this was important in La Crescenta, where they felt they didn't get their part of Measure R because they weren't part of the COG, but they were part of the planning area. So Measure R is driven by the planning area, not the COG boundary. So provided that the planning area boundary and the COG boundary are the same and you've properly calculated the percentages, if the project were to receive a 2/3 vote of the board to be certified as completed, even though we hadn't done anything, so that we could move the money to something else, or we did a notice of an amendment a year ahead of time and then did a 2/3 vote to free up the money. Some of the money would come to the central area planning area, and some would come to the San Gabriel Valley area for a discussion. Now, once those discussions had concluded, you would still need to bring the whole thing back to the board for that 2/3 vote. So it's politically very difficult to get through, and I think the board set it up that way on purpose to make sure that everyone's sort of bailiwick was protected. That's how we got 2/3 vote.
So is there a map of these planning areas in Measure R?
There are maps of the planning areas available. They are in the technical document for the 2009 long-range plan. I think that's where you get the most detail about them. But there's been enough discussion amongst the board members about this COG area boundary problem that we also have other maps that our GIS people have generated that we could get out there if you needed them. Over here.
How is it that the cost of Measure R's projects exceed the revenues that Measure R would take in? It seems illogical that they would have so many more projects that they're unfunded. How can they have created such a monstrosity?
This is my fault. In constructing the Measure R program, we had a very similar challenge that we have for the next sales tax if we put one on the ballot. The demands out there are just too large to fund. And so one of the strategies we used in Measure R to craft a measure that got something for everyone is we assumed leveraging revenues from the federal government, from the state, and even from local agencies. So that was all built into the planning that went into the thing that got put on the ballot. And you can see it in the attachment to the measure. It's attachment A to the ordinance, and I call it vitamin A because I very rarely go through a day where I don't need to go look at it what the hell did we say on this project? Because it's real complicated, and I appreciate the fact that it looks crazy, but it worked. And let me just tell you how well it worked. The TIFI allowance that we've gotten based on Measure R are now at $1.5 billion once we secure the subway one this month. When we get the full funding grant agreement for the subway, it's $1.25 billion. We'll be up at the $2 billion mark in the first decade for federal New Starts funds. Huge victory for Los Angeles. We never would have gotten that money without a carefully constructed Measure R strategy that leveraged that money. So it's working. It's been tough for people's expectations that, you know, we voted on something and now we still have to go get the money. Yes, you do. And we're doing it. So we're over here, and now I'll come back to you again.
So I was interested to see the airport metro connector on your list of projects here that would be accelerated with 3010 funds, and the airport metro connector has obviously been in the news this week with LA World Airports coming out with some preliminary proposals around what they would do that frankly don't really connect with anything that Metro has discussed at this point. So I'm curious to hear a little bit more about what Metro is doing in speaking and working with LAWA to actually create a functional connection to the airport.
Yeah, I can only speak broadly about the funding. Measure R isn't enough to do anything out there. There's some number
200 million?
200 million, maybe something like that in Measure R, and there's a complement from the long range plan that would go with it, and some right of way that Metro owns. But the lion's share of the money's got to come out of the airport planning process. Our board is super focused on this issue right now, and I don't know if you've already done it, Bart, but getting some of those people in here who know about airport connection planning might be an interesting night for you. I don't know the details. They are quite complicated. They range from, you know, building a light rail tunnel all the way under the far end of the Tom Bradley terminal to, you know, passenger connections to the Crenshaw line as it's being built now. There's something called the hernia where it would come out of the Crenshaw line and be built later to hook up to whatever the airport wants. It's a hugely complicated planning problem, and we have some of the best in the business looking at it, and you might get them down here. Like, I hate to throw Renee Berlin under the bus here, but I don't know if you've had her in lately.
Well, actually, they have a deadline. For those that don't know, there's a planning deadline date for the board of directors for June, so perhaps in July or August, actually have that. I know there is some LAWA and some other people there. I don't know if anybody's authorized to talk, and if not, then I can essentially explain, to answer your question a little bit, that there's always been, if anybody's been to JFK, that knows that there's a circulator system that circles around the airport. It takes care of the hotel buses, it takes care of the rental car buses, it takes care of the employees that get off the Jamaica L and the Howard Beach elevator and the Long Island Railroad. It takes care of, I think I mentioned rental cars, it takes care of the five markets that go to the airport, and it takes care of the employees that go to the airport. LAWA has 54,000 badged employees that need access to the airport. Plenty of travelers, of course, and then all those other market shares. So LAWA has, as David mentioned, put together a couple of iterations of how a people mover would circulate through the airport, because the nature of the airport is they wanted to have a good throughput, so once you get on at one end of Terminal 1, you can get around to Terminal 7, 8, and 9, if they ever do 9, and get there quickly and traverse. The political dilemma is that some people think that the light rail system should go to the center of the airport, and that leaves you the situation that you have at O'Hare, where you're in the middle of the airport, then you have to walk 15, 20 minutes to get to any of the terminals. So the concept here is that the World Airport People Mover will connect to the Metro regional connection, so that way you'll be able to get across the region and get to the People Mover. The People Mover goal, I think, is to get you from the Green Line or the Crenshaw Line two-year terminal within 5 to 9 minutes, so you have a very quick throughput with trains every 2 minutes. So that isn't sufficient to some of the supervisors at the Metro Board, and so there's this, you know, immovable object and unstoppable object that are trying to battle on how we're going to come through with that iteration. It will be something that after June, when the goal of the board gets accomplished with the planning, that we can have a meeting and explain it. But it's actually exciting because I looked at my notes 10 or 12 years ago and could never get anybody to move on it. The James Hahn people didn't want to deal with any of this. And as recently as a year or two ago, they were even talking about doing bus rapid transit around the airport. It's like, well, we already have that. So we're actually, by this decade, going to have, we'll yield a project that will move people by some sort of automated people mover and get good throughput around the airport, solve all those market needs of the different people, and you'll be able to get to regional transit. And unfortunately, because of the size of LA, people don't understand is you can't just run a train from Sylmar to the South Bay or somewhere. You've got to have transfers and connections because in the rail network, it's a grid because of the density and the size of our region. Anyways, back to David and Jason.
I can take a couple more questions. I think, Jan, you had one.
I was just curious because mostly we're talking about tolls, but on a couple of other evenings here, we heard both Doug Failing and Roger Molieri talk about P3 availability model of P3s.
Uh-huh.
Do you envision which any of these projects falling under that as opposed to a scenario
pure
P3? Yeah, where the contractor is actually.
Yeah, this question actually is a very good one. It's come up with in a workshop we had with the qualified teams that were released earlier this week. The availability payment scheme is another form, in my mind, of debt service that you're going to be committed to paying this mm-hmm. money over a period of time. We enjoy some of the best borrowing rates of any public agency in the country because we're very highly rated by the rating agencies for our sales tax bonds. So the availability payment scheme doesn't save you money just on the financial side. The savings come in when you bring in the motivation of the private sector in managing the project for those availability payments. In other words, bringing in the operating and maintenance and life cycle costs of the project and having a banker behind it who's responsible for making sure that that project's maintained properly. That's where the savings are supposed to be in the availability payment scheme. And so that's my rudimentary understanding. Don't ask me a follow-up question, please.
Well, I guess my question really was, are you still considering that for some of these projects, and if so, which ones?
Well,
I mean, it's clear, like, you know, light rail, yes, people pay to use it, but it isn't the same as toll collection.
The one project that has something analogous to this is the Doyle Drive project in the San Francisco Bay Area, where near the end of the Golden Gate Bridge, they have availability payments that are sponsored by the state as part of their operating cost concession to the project. We are open to ideas that involve our money from the sales tax side coming in an availability scheme if it pencils out better than our own borrowing strategy, if it's necessary to bring in these motivations to maintain the life cycle of the project and operate it in a proper way. So it's not a simple yes or no answer. Over here, I think you had a question?
No, I didn't have a question about what Bart was describing about LAWA's plan. I was going to let the gentleman know. I was at a meeting this morning, and LAWA has presented their plans for their APMs to the board, so they said it would be online, showing all their different recommendations.
And over here,
I just had a question. You mentioned on the financings that were done on Measure R that each one's a further subordinate.
Yeah.
Borrowing, is that common to sales tax backed deals? Is that a function of Measure R? Is that a function of investors on the deals demanding a cutoff of their lien, or how did that sort of super subordination end up getting in there?
Well,
a lot of times in a revenue-based deal, you often have parity borrowings,
right,
a water system or something like that.
Right. Within certain limits, you can get parity borrowing where you're not subordinated. Our senior borrowers don't like to see someone jumping in ahead of them, and typically we layer them in behind. It's still a superior loan because there's so much sales tax backing it up.
You still here?
Yeah, so it's essentially parity, but it I think it's technically subordinate. In the TIFIA program, they had a provision before America Fast Forward, which called a springing lien, which would jump the TIFIA loan in the event of bankruptcy to parity with the senior borrowers. Well, that essentially took us out of the game. We weren't allowed to do arrangement where it would spring up with the other senior borrowers without going to ask those borrowers for permission, and they were never going to give it to us. And so in America Fast Forward TIFIA, the one we actually got, we had a provision to wipe out the springing lien, and the regional connector and the subway deals are the first deals that the federal government has done without the springing lien in it.
And on the proposed tax credit legislation that you mentioned, is that proposed to be applicable to any transit entity, or is it somehow special to Los Angeles?
Anybody with an income stream that is rated highly enough to attract private investment. If the rates for this stuff is set on the market, so if you are a poor credit risk, the interest isn't going to look free to you. It's going to have a cost of, it'll be lower because there'll be that tax credit subsidy there, but it won't be free. If you're a highly rated borrower like Metro, we believe we can get pretty close to interest-free in our arrangement that we're proposing. So I've got time for one more question, and this guy back here has been very patient with me.
As someone who studied a little bit of transportation history in the state of California, I'm kind of cautiously optimistic about private-public partnerships, because I know that our legendary red car system was a private enterprise, and when it failed, it wrapped up because, you know, they had to liquidate as metal for the tracks. So my concern is that when we're having private-public partnerships on rail tunnels, who ultimately owns the rail tunnel? Does the private investor own the rail tunnel, or do the people own the rail tunnel once it's all paid off?
The deal can be set up any way you want. Typically, there'll be a very long-term concessionaire agreement where the private operator owns that thing virtually, but it returns to public ownership at the end of the agreement period. It could be 50 years, 100 years, 25 years, whatever whatever pencils out in that particular circumstance. Some of the very promising areas of public-private partnerships would be in lowering operating costs by contracting out the operation of our system. Those are very dicey agreements to get because of the vested interest we have in our labor partnerships on operating our system. So we've looked at them, but we're not likely to go there anytime soon. Okay, I'd like to stay longer and talk to you all. You guys are a pretty active group, and thank you for having me. I've left a couple business cards here if you want to follow up and catch me later, and I've got to get going. So thank you. Let's give David a big hand.